Half a day, students. My name is Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. As we battle this COVID-19 outbreak, I want you to know that together, Governor Liu and I are working very hard to do everything within our power to keep our island safe from COVID-19. In addition, we have been working closely with the Guam Department of Education and PBS Guam to bring you continuous educational curriculum while you stay home during this time. With that said, Governor Liang Guerrero and I want you to remember to stay safe. This means listening to your parents. Wash your hands for at least 20 seconds and wash your hands frequently. Together, we will get through this. To our parents, the governor and I know how important it is that we stay diligent in our efforts to keep our students of Guam healthy and safe. Thank you for stepping in with your child's education during this time. I would also like to thank each and every member of the Guam DOE team, teachers and support staff, for their hard work, boundless energy, and for their commitment to our students of Guam. To our students, we hope that you enjoy PBS University while at home. Have a great lesson.
PBS University is a program by the Guam Department of Education, PBS Guam, and in conjunction with public school teachers to create lessons that students will be able to easily follow. With the aim of helping students continue their learning at home, providing both parents and students with a unique educational experience. PBS University on PBS Guam.
Half a day, my name is John Fernandez, Superintendent of the Guam Department of Education. I want to begin by thanking you all for staying home and staying safe during the current COVID-19 pandemic. Let's continue to do our part by practicing good hygiene, social distancing, and staying home. I know it's not easy, but we can do this. Remember, we are all in this together. I know you understand why we had to close schools down for the rest of the school year, and I want you to know that your safety, the safety of your families, and the safety of employees come first. But let's not give up on teaching and learning. As you know, we have already provided a set of distance learning resources that are now on our website at www.gdoe.net. Now we're taking it to the next level with the help of Guam Public Broadcasting Service, better known as PBS. We will be launching PBS University, which will contain televised weekly lessons developed by our teachers and staff for students from K-12. These will be simple but effective lessons for students to work on at home, and they will include lessons in reading, math, and character development. These lessons will be updated weekly for the remainder of the school year and into the summer. Students, here's your opportunity to keep your mind sharp while you're stuck at home over the next few weeks. And parents, I hope that this will assist you in providing your children with dedicated instructional time and support. I want to close by just thanking those people on the front lines of the COVID-19 fight, our healthcare professionals, including our very own DOE school nurses and social workers, our law enforcement professionals, including our very own DOE student attendance officers and school resource officers, our principals and school staff, who along with Sodexo employees serve 24,000 school meals to feed our island's children, our food and nutrition employees who are delivering food supplies to our nonprofit and government partners to assist needy families, and our teachers and staff who have worked hard to make distance learning a reality. Finally, a message to students, keep a positive attitude, keep learning, we miss you, and we'll see you soon in the new school year. Sijus maasi, and stay safe.
Really? All of that happened? Oh, that is just too funny. Hold on, okay, just a minute. Hi, boys and girls. This is Miss Jenny Ann Flores, first and second grade literacy teacher to children all over the world, coming to you from PBS University. My friend was just telling me the story about a cookie and a mouse. It came from this book, If You Give a Mouse a Cookie, by Laura Joff Numeroff, and pictures by Felicity Vaughn. If you give a mouse a cookie, he's going to ask for a glass of milk. When you give him the milk, he'll probably ask for a straw. When he's finished, he'll ask for a napkin. Then, he'll want to look in a mirror to make sure he doesn't have a milk mustache. When he looks in the mirror,
he might notice his hair needs a trim. So, he'll probably ask for a pair of nail scissors. When he's finished giving himself a trim, he'll want a broom to sweep up. Of course, he'll start sweeping. He might get carried away and sweep every room in the house. He may even end up washing the floors as well. When he's done, he'll probably want to take a nap. He'll have to fix up a little box for him with a blanket and a pillow. He'll crawl in, make himself comfortable, and fluff the pillow a few times. He'll probably ask you to read him a story. This mouse is something else. So, you read to him from one of your books and he'll ask to see the pictures. When he looks at the pictures, he'll get so excited he'll want to draw one of his own. He'll ask for paper and crayons. He'll draw a picture. When the picture is finished, he'll want to sign his name. Well, of course, with a pen. Then he'll want to hang his picture on your refrigerator, which means he'll need scotch tape. He'll hang up his drawing and stand back to look at it. Looking at the refrigerator will remind him that he's thirsty. So, here we are, you're so tired cleaning up after this mouse. So, he'll ask for a glass of milk. And chances are, if he asks for a glass of milk, what will happen, boys and girls? He's going to want a cookie to go with it. Well, we all know, if you give a mouse a cookie.
I hope you enjoy that, boys and girls. Now we're going to learn about four kinds of sentences. I'm going to read some sentences from the story and then we're going to convert them to four kinds of sentences. If you give a mouse a cookie, he's going to ask for a glass of milk. First sentence, the mouse likes milk and cookies. Second sentence, do you have milk and cookies? Third sentence, I love milk and cookies. Now, fourth sentence, give me milk and cookies. Okay, number one, the mouse likes milk and cookies. It just tells you something. It gives you information. It states an idea. It ends full stop with a period. It's a simple or declarative sentence. Number two, do you have milk and cookies? It asks you for information. It asks a question. That's what it is. A question or an interrogative sentence. It ends with a question mark. Okay, let's review that. The mouse likes milk and cookies. What kind of sentence, boys and girls? Simple or declarative sentence. Do you have milk and cookies? What kind of sentence? A question or interrogative sentence. Number three. I love milk and cookies. Okay, it shows strong emotions or feelings. I love milk and cookies. It ends in an exclamation point. So, it's an exclamation. Four, give me milk and cookies. Okay, now the sentence tells someone what to do. It makes a request. You can end in a period, or it can end in an exclamation point. Give me milk and cookies. It's a command. Okay, let's do a review. First sentence was a what? A simple or a declarative sentence. The mouse likes milk and cookies. The second sentence was a question. Do you have milk and cookies? The third sentence was an exclamation. I love milk and cookies. The The fourth sentence was a command. Give me milk and cookies. Okay, I'm going to read a passage from the book and then we're going to come up with our four sentences. Then he looks in the mirror to make sure he doesn't have a milk mustache. When he looks in the mirror, he might notice his hair needs a trim. Okay, come up with a simple or declarative sentence, a question, an exclamation, and a command. Then he'll ask for a mirror to make sure he doesn't have a milk mustache. When he looks in the mirror, he might notice that he needs it. Okay, this is our declarative sentence. The mouse wants a mirror. This is our question. This is our question. Do I have a milk mustache? This is our exclamation. I need a trim. This is our command. Give me a mirror. Okay, here's another passage from the book. He'll start sweeping. He might get carried away and sweep every room in the house. He may even end up washing the floors as well. Okay, now you come up with a simple or declarative sentence, a question, an exclamation, and a command. Actually, you don't have to take it from the book. You can come up with any sentence that is a simple or declarative sentence, a question, or an exclamation or a command. Okay, here's what I came up with. He swept every room in the house. Simple declarative sentence. Did he also wash the floor? Question. He started sweeping. Exclamation. Give me a broom. Give me a broom. Give me a broom. Command. I hope you enjoyed that, boys and girls. If You Give a Mouse a Cookie is one of my favorite stories of all time. And today, we learn about four kinds of sentences. This is Miss Jenny Ann Flores, first and second grade literacy teacher to children all over the world, coming to you from PBS University. Bye!
Hi, my name is Ron and I'm reporting for Nani News.
I'm Joanna, I'm reporting for Nani News.
One of the ways we get exercise and get fresh air and spend time together is by riding our bikes.
My name is Mia, and I'm going to learn how to ride my bike without training wheels.
My name is Tori.
My name is Mia.
My name is Lily.
My name is Troy.
And today we're going to cook peppers with Mama Grape and Papa Grape.
Thank you.
some yoga.
Namaste.
Coming down to your knees, everybody, and tuck yourself up into a tiny little mouse pose. He stays in his tiny little bed. Coming up to stand, join your feet together and your hands together above your head, and take yourself over to one side. Falling forward, take hold of your ankles and come on.
That's it for our episode of Many News. I'm Cohen.
I'm Julian. Family first.
I'm Mia, and safety first.
I'm training like ice cream.
Thanks for watching.
Bye. Bye. Thanks for watching.
If you would like to be featured on Many News to share what you are doing at home to stay healthy, happy, and safe, you can go to our website, manyelu.org, and click on Many News. There, you will find all the steps your parents or guardians need to take for you to be featured.
We are excited to hear from you.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to PBS University. I am Miss Perez. Today, we're going to work on how to solve word problems. Word problems can be tricky, but I have a little help for you to remember what to think about when you're working on the word problems.
Think of the word cubes. Cubes can help us think how to solve the word problem. You circle the numbers that you know, underline the question, box the math action, evaluate and eliminate what you don't need, solve your work, and check. Don't forget the word cubes.
Do you know you use word problems in real life? Well, let's think if you're helping your mom cook in the kitchen. There are 5 eggs in the refrigerator. Your mom asks you to get 2 eggs. How many eggs do you have left in the refrigerator? See? So that is one example. Let's think of another example of how you can use word problems in real life. You have 3 pencils. And you find one more in your backpack. How many pencils do you have now? Yes, you have 4 pencils now. There's a clue in that sentence that helps you think what you use if you're adding or subtracting. You find one more pencil. Yes, finding it. When you find something, you have it. And we'll also go over a couple of word problems step by step. I will help you. Just remember, you have to look for the key words to know if you're going to add, subtract, multiply, or divide.
Let's solve some word problems. First, we need to think of cubes. Cubes is the word that will help us remember what steps we need to do to help us solve the word problems. C. Circle numbers. So what do I know? U. Underline the question. What am I being asked? B. Box math action words. Am I going to add, subtract, multiply, or divide? We look for the words that give us hints on what we should do. E. Evaluate and eliminate. What steps do I take? What information don't I need? We look at the word problem and we take away the extra words that confuse us. S. Solve your work and check. Does my answer make sense? How can I double check? This is where we start to solve our problems. Sometimes I like to draw out my work. Here it is, cubes. Circle, underline, box, evaluate, and show. Hannah had 17 dolls, but she gave 4 to her sister. How many dolls does she have left? Hannah has blank dolls. Okay, let's think of what do we do next when we're thinking of cubes. C, circle the numbers. What do we know so far? Let's look at the word problem again. Let's look for the numbers. What are the numbers? Yes, 17 and 4. We circle 17 and 4. Next, you. Underline the question. What am I being asked? How many dolls does she have left? Yes. Underline it. Good job. Next, B. Box math action words. Am I going to add, subtract, multiply, or divide? Let's look at the word problem and find any clues. Hannah had 17 dolls, but she gave 4 to her sister. How many dolls does she have left? Do you see any clues? Do you see any words that will help give you clues? The word gave, yes. Gave, you don't have it anymore. You gave it away. And also, how many dolls does she have left also gives you a clue that she gave some away but still has some. So yes, we're going to box gave and how many dolls left. And this will tell us what we do. What do we do? Do we add, subtract, multiply, or divide? Yes, we're going to subtract. E, evaluate and eliminate. What steps do I take and what information don't I need? Back at the problem. Looking at this, there are words that we don't need, so we're going to eliminate to help reduce our confusion. Do you see any words we could cross off? Yes, we're going to cross these off because all we need are the numbers 17, 4, the keyword gave, and the question, how many dolls left? S, show your work and check. Does my answer make sense? How can I double check? So looking at the problem again, we're going to pull out the numbers. 17 and 4. And remember, what do we use? The minus sign. Yes, we're going to subtract. So we have 17 minus 4 equals what number? And remember, we could write it the different way in the column. 17 minus 4 equals what number? We can also draw to help us solve. Here are 17 dolls. So what do we do next? What did Hannah do? She gave 4 away. So I crossed out 4 dolls. And look at the problem now. 17 minus 4 equals what number? Now let's think. What will the answer be? We could count the dolls. Or we could work out the problem. So what is the answer? 13, yes. Hannah has 13 dolls left. It's been great working with all of you. I hope you've learned a lot, and I hope you remember when you're in school how to work word problems. Don't forget, what's the word? Cubes, yes. Great job, great thinking, and good work. Now remember, be safe, wash your hands, and think, what can you do today to help somebody? Maybe you could help them solve a problem. Until then, take care, and I'll see you next time.
I'm Lexis Ross, and I'm reporting from Cannon Beach. I'm here with some citizen scientists from Coast, and we're out here looking for some dead birds.
My name is Rita Catching.
I'm Pete Catching.
We are citizen scientists.
I'm Patrick Reynolds.
I'm Lori Reynolds, and we're Coast volunteers.
And we're a team. We've been doing this since 2002.
Julia Parrish is the founder of the Coastal Observation and Seabird Survey Team, also known as COAST, and she travels all over training citizens to collect data for her organization.
Citizen science is that perfect blend of the social and the data-driven. And it makes me realize that science is a social thing. It's not something that you do all by yourself. It's something that you do with a team of people. And I just have a really, really large team.
We go out once a month to the same beach, and we walk a mile, and we search for dead birds. We call them beach birds, so it doesn't sound so bad.
And we learn to identify those from limited information. Usually with like a head and a wing and a foot.
We have three measurements that we take. We do an identification and record all that. We take a couple photos for verification.
Seabirds are really good way of keeping the pulse of the ecosystem, and that's because they're really easy to see and they're really easy to monitor. In fact, they're a lot easier to monitor than fish, because fish are under the surface of the ocean and birds are on top of it. So when we see mass mortality events of seabirds, we know they are not the only things that are dying.
We tell people that we look for dead birds, and the immediate reaction is, ew, but yet when we find a bird and we actually do the work of identifying it and measuring it and looking it up in the book and finding out about the bird, it's just interesting is the only word to describe it. We have learned so much.
When I started Coast, I thought, well, who's going to be interested in going out on the beach and finding dead birds? People who were interested, it turns out, are people who have a really, really strong connection to a particular place on the beach. It's their beach. They speak about it that way. They don't say, I'm going to the beach. They say, I'm going to my beach.
Neither of us spent our careers in science, so this is one way to keep learning after we've retired and produce a database of information that will outlive us.
We've got 17 years of records. So we're kind of
1,700 birds and counting.
Yeah, that's right.
Seeing the data summarized in different ways is very, very useful. And we're part of this from Alaska to California. And so I like that.
It is important to people to monitor those birds and figure out what's going on, because they are giving us signals that the larger system are changing, and that's going to have ramifications to our way of life.
I just find it fascinating, and I'm not sure I can explain why, but I love getting a close look at the birds that I would never get just looking through binoculars.
I feel like we're in a revolution. I feel like last century, last millennium, that was the century of academic science, that science is performed inside the walls, the ivory tower of the university. This century, I think this is the century of citizen science. This is the century where everybody gets involved and we break down those walls, and together we use science to change the world.
Right now, nature's under attack, and we feel like if we contribute something to help salvage at least our little part of the world, then we want to do it.
This has been Lexis Ross from Student Reporting Labs. Ooh!
Oh, hi there, guys. This is Mr. Nicholas. I was just blowing up some balloons for my cousin's birthday party tomorrow. Speaking of parties, I have a joke. Are you ready? Knock, knock. What's the matter? Trick question. Everything is matter. Everything around us is made of matter, even the things that we cannot see. In today's lesson, we are going to be talking about the three states of matter: solid, liquid, and gas. Are you ready? Fantastic!
You're going to be hearing the word molecules. Molecules are the smallest unit of a substance that is still the substance. How they move and behave determines whether that substance or material is going to be a solid, a liquid, or a gas. In solids, the molecules are packed tightly together and do not move away from each other. This allows them to keep its shape.
Okay, guys, some examples of a solid that I found around my house were this delicious red apple, this pretty cool decorative wooden ball, and my dog's chew toy.
In liquids, the molecules are free to move, but they still stay close together. This allows them to change its shape, but they always take up the same amount of space.
Okay, now let's look at a liquid that we see all the time and we drink every single day. That's right, I'm talking about water. I just got 8 cups of my regular tap water from my sink, and I put a little bit of blue food coloring in there so that you could see it clearly. What I want you guys to notice is how the liquid looks as I pour it into each container. Remember, I am not changing the amount of liquid that I have. I'm just pouring it into a different container. Are you ready? Fantastic! One characteristic of a liquid is that it takes the shape of its container, but it does not always fill the entire container.
Our last state of matter is gases. In gases, the molecules are free to move apart from each other. It fills the container it is in, unlike liquids or solids.
To demonstrate gases, I've got the balloon that I was blowing up for my cousin's birthday tomorrow and a plastic bag. How do you guys think I blew up this balloon? Right, I had to blow some air into it. Let's see if I can do the same thing with this Ziploc. Now I trapped some air into my Ziploc. Huh. Can you guys see anything in this bag? No! That's right, most gases are invisible, meaning we can't see them, but I know that it's there. I think I heard someone say out there that farts mean you're passing gas. Oh my goodness. Well, you're not wrong. Think about when someone has an extra stinky fart. P.U. Can you see the fart that somebody made? No, but can you smell it? Yes, some gases have a smell to them or an odor, and that's another way to prove that even though we can't see them, we sure know that they're there. Okay guys, I'm going to show 2 of my scientist friends, and they're gonna talk a little bit more about the 3 states of matter.
Maybe I could explain the states of matter with dance.
A dancing scientist.
I don't believe it. Believe it, bro.
That I did not expect.
In order to understand the states of matter, I'd like to introduce you to my good friends, the Gregory Brothers. Hit it!
What is happening?
We're gonna show you how to dance the states of matter.
Are you sure you're a real scientist?
Liquid water. This is water as a gas, and this is solid water. That might seem confusing, but we're here to explain.
Water is wet until it is not. It changes a lot when it gets cold or hot. If you heat it up to 100 degrees, it evaporates into a cloud of steam.
Let's dance like a gas would dance. When liquid turns into a gas, it spreads out all around as far as it can go, and it's invisible.
Now the water is part of the air. The particles float around everywhere. But when it cools down, the gas condenses. The water is wet all over again.
Now let's dance just like a liquid would,
flowing around to fill the space. Just like me, water, the most famous liquid in the world.
Water is wet until it is not. It changes a lot when it gets cold or hot. If you cool it down past 0 degrees, you get solid ice, 'cause that water will freeze.
Now let's dance like a solid would. Stay really still and keep your shape rigid.
Now the water is solid ice. It can't change its shape or its size. Heat it up, then it will melt. And guess what? That water is wet.
Now it's your turn. Stand up and sing and dance with us.
Water is wet until it is not. It changes a lot when it gets cold or hot. If you heat it up to 100 degrees, it evaporates into a cloud of steam.
Let's dance like a gas would dance. When liquid turns into a gas, it spreads out all around as far as it can go, and it's invisible.
Now the water is part of the air. The particles float around everywhere. But when it cools down, the gas condenses. The water is wet all over again.
Now let's dance just like a liquid would,
flowing around to fill the space. Just like me, water, the most famous liquid in the world.
Water is wet until it is not. It changes a lot when it gets cold or hot. If you cool it down past 0 degrees, you get solid ice, 'cause that water will freeze.
Now let's dance like a solid would. Stay really still and keep your shape rigid.
Now the water is solid ice. It can't change its shape or its size. Heat it up, then it will melt. And guess what? That water is wet.
Now dance however you want to dance.
Flowing like a liquid, bouncing around like a gas, or rigid like a solid.
Now, modern scientists in training, let's review. The ice in my friend's hand is a solid. Brr, cold. The water on his hands is a liquid and very wet. And finally, that water vapor coming out is a gas. Ice is a solid, but when we add heat, it melts and turns into water. Water is a liquid, but when we cool it down to 0 degrees Celsius, it freezes and turns into ice. Water is a liquid, but when it heats up to 100 degrees Celsius, it evaporates and turns into water vapor or gas.
Okay, you guys, thank you so much for joining me today. I'll see you next time. Bye.
I'm Carol Klepek, and I've lived in Ithaca for the last 30 years. I love the Finger Lakes area. I love the lakes. I love the rolling agricultural lands, the forests, the spring wildflowers. And I've supported the Finger Lakes Land Trust, so when I heard that they were starting a phenology project, I became interested in learning more about it and then participating in it.
My name is Hannah George, and I'm the Conservation Easement Steward here at the Finger Lakes Land Trust. The Finger Lakes Land Trust has a phenology trail at the Roy H. Park Preserve in Dryden, New York, a place where people can go on a hike and record their observations of six different trees that are part of a national database.
I wasn't familiar with the word phenology until the Land Trust began its project last spring.
Phenology is the study of seasons and how animals and plants respond to those seasonal changes. For example, in plants, flowers opening for the first time that spring, falling leaves, breaking leaf buds, those are all phenological events, which we call phenophases.
There's an app on my phone which records the data. It's all set up with the stations that Hannah has put in front of certain trees that they want to document week after week.
That data actually gets entered into this national database that people such as scientists or other people interested in plants, they can look at that data and use it for their research. I started the phenology trail with my fellow intern, Nick Dietschler, and he's actually also using citizen science to help with combating this invasive pest that's threatening our forests.
The hemlock woolly adelgid, or HWA for short, is an aphid-like insect that was introduced to the East Coast from Japan in the early 1900s. Hemlock woolly adelgid was first detected in the Finger Lakes region in 2008. It's spread pretty rapidly throughout the Finger Lakes.
This pest has moved in and has been causing the decline of hemlock trees, and these trees make up more than 25% of our forests in this region.
We have a steep slope behind our little lake cottage, and there's hemlocks that have been badly affected by woolly adelgids, and you see kind of hemlock stands that, it's so sad. These magnificent trees that have just look like they're sick.
Here in the lab, we raise predators that feed on hemlock woolly adelgid. Currently, we're working with a beetle, Laricobius nigrinus, or Little Larry, and a species of fly called silver flies. These predators are native to where hemlock woolly adelgid comes from, and we bring them here to New York State to research them and release them into the wild to help control hemlock woolly adelgid across its introduced range and protect hemlock trees for the future. By enlisting citizen science observers around the state, they give us the information that we need so we can release the predators at the appropriate time of year. And this is crucial in the success of the biological control program. So we release the predators when they have the right life stage of the adelgid to feed on. Citizen science observations like these are really important for many different types of research. And the phenology trail at the Park Preserve is another place where these types of crucial observations can be gathered for researchers to use.
A lot of the people that visit the trail don't know what phenology is, but when they get there, they find out that there's actually a way for them to get involved in citizen science. What's interesting is that a lot of people don't know what these trees are, and they walk past them every single day. Red maple, sugar maple, white pine, a lot of people just look at those and they're just another leafy plant.
I think to go out to the same area week after week and just see the changes and, you know, turning from brown to vibrant green, and now there's bird song and now there's insects buzzing around, and it's just this blossoming of this living planet that's so exciting.
You start with water, with warm or cold. Make sure the water's running when you turn it on. Be sure to lather when you're at home. And when you buy essentials outside of your zone, you have to get the back of your hands and between your feet in this too. Don't think too hard about it, just have fun. Ooh, get every nook and cranny beneath your fingernails too. Just rinse them down and dry them up and you're done. When you wash your hands, make sure the germs go. Sing happy birthday twice so you know. Count to 20 or play this video and sing it with me.
Sing
sneeze and you wash your hands before you eat and after eating you wash your hands. Come on. All those things you touch outside, you should wash your hands. Do your house a favor and keep washing.
Don't point your fingers.
You should wash your hands. When you wash your hands, make sure the germs go. Sing happy birthday twice so you know. Count to 20 or play this video. And sing it with me.
Sing it with me.
Sing with me. When you cough or when you sneeze, and you wash your hands. Before you eat and after eating, you wash your hands. Come on. All those things you touch outside, you should wash your hands. Do your house a favor and keep washing. Got to get between my fingers. Got to get underneath my nails. Come on. Got to get between my fingers. Got to get underneath my nails. Come on. Got to get between my fingers. Got to get underneath my nails, come on.
Good afternoon, it's time to learn. Good afternoon, it's time to learn.
Boys and girls, and welcome back to PBS University Guam. Mrs. Stella here. I'm going to be your social studies teacher for today for first and second grade. I wonder what you think we're going to learn about. If we take a look out here, what do you see? The ocean. Do you know how many oceans there are? Well, we're going to learn about the oceans, and we're also going to learn about the seven continents.
Let's look at our learning goal for today, and you can read along as I read aloud with you. I can identify the five oceans and seven continents. Great job reading along for our learning goal. So here we have a picture of the world map that shows the seven continents. Each of the continents are color-coded in a different color. So please repeat after me as I review the seven continents. North America, South America, Europe, Asia, Africa, Australia, and another name for Australia is also called Oceania, and the seventh continent is Antarctica. Now I want to sing you a song, so sing along with me. It's sung to the tune of Pup Goes the Weasel, but it's singing all the seven continents in the order I've showed you. Are you ready? Let's sing. North and South America, Europe, Asia too, Africa, Australia, Antarctica, it's true. So these are the seven continents, and I hope, boys and girls, that you can look and see what the seven continents are at home and memorize. Now here we have the same map with the seven continents we've just reviewed, and now we're going to go over the five oceans. So please repeat after me. Pacific Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, Indian Ocean, Arctic Ocean, and Southern Ocean. Just like we did with the seven continents, I would also like to sing you a song with the five oceans to help you memorize them at home. There are five oceans in the world, and this is what we call them. Pacific, Atlantic, Indian, and Arctic. Southern is the newest, and these are the five oceans. Pacific, Atlantic, Indian, Arctic, and Southern. The five oceans. So here I have an online game I'd like to show you to help you at home to memorize the seven continents and the five oceans. Please make sure before you go online that you have an adult with you to help supervise as you go online and as you type in to make sure you're putting the correct spelling and the correct punctuation. We're going to be looking at theworldgeographygames.com. So up here, you're going to click at the address and you're going to type in www.world/geography/games.com. Now, please make sure that you go up and double check your spelling and make sure you have the correct punctuations in between. I have a dot here and a dash, another dash, and another dot. So please make sure that it looks exactly as it is on my screen as you're typing it on your screen. When you're done, click enter. It's going to take you to this home page. Now, there are different types of games you can play, so when we're done with today's lesson, please make sure you go back and try out any of the other games. But for today, I'd like you to focus on the World Games. Once you've clicked the World Games, it's going to take you to this menu. And we're going to do two games for today. The first one, we're going to practice the continents. So click continents. As it's loading, wait for it to show this symbol and press play. This is what your map's going to look like. When you're ready to begin the test or the quiz game, click anywhere on the map to play. At the top, it's going to give you the continent it wants you to find. At the top over here, it's going to show you how many attempts or tries that you've done and your score. Remember, you're trying to get 7 out of 7 correct. If for some reason you couldn't realize or you don't remember where the continents are located, you can click the solution. The solution will give you the answers for you to review quickly, then you can stop and play again. So don't forget, when you're ready, click play, click anywhere on the map, and begin. Let's try out a couple together. At the top, it's telling us to find which continent. South America. Do you know where South America is? I'm going to hover over each continent and you tell me where to stop. Is this South America? No. Is this South America? You think this is South America? I'll stop here. Let's click. We are correct. This is South America. Now, what's the next continent it's telling us to find? Africa. I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to hover over each of the continents and you tell me where to stop. Is this Africa? Nope. Is this Africa? You want to try? Maybe? Let's see. Oh, shucks. That's incorrect. But that's okay. We can try again. Let's see. Is this Africa? You don't think that's Africa? What about this? Is this Africa? Oh, so you want me to stop here and click it? Let's try. Wow, you're correct. Great job. The next one it's telling us to find is Antarctica. Now, let's try the bottom part here. Is this Antarctica? You want me to stop right here? Let me press and click it. You are correct. Antarctica is at the bottom. We have 4 more to go. Asia. Is this Asia? You don't think that's Asia? Okay. Is this Asia? You want me to try the next one over? How about this? Is this Asia? You want me to stop here? Okay, let's click it. You are correct, boys and girls. You're doing fantastic. How about we finish this round and we can go to the oceans? Now we're going to try to do the oceans game. So click on the oceans. And just like we waited for it to load, press play when it's ready. We're going to use the same map. And this time we're just focusing on the 5 oceans. So click anywhere on the map when you're ready to play. And it's the same layout. So let's begin. I'm going to click here. Southern Ocean. I'm going to hover over the map. And if you think it's here, then tell me to stop. If you want me to go on, then tell me to go on. All right, I'll go on. Do you think this is the Southern Ocean? No. How about here? Is this the Southern Ocean? How about down here? You want me to stop? Let's click it here. You are correct. Now, Pacific Ocean. Don't forget, that's also where Guam's located, in the Pacific Ocean. Is Guam located up here? No. What about here? No. So you want me to hover over here? Let's click it. You are correct. The Pacific Ocean is here. Arctic Ocean. Is Arctic Ocean up here? Wow, boys and girls, you want me to stop here? Okay, let's see. You are correct. Up here is the Arctic Ocean. Now the Indian Ocean. Should I stop here and click here? What happens? Oh no, it's incorrect. That means the Indian Ocean is over here. Ta-da! Now that's the correct place, which shows us the Atlantic Ocean is here. Excellent job. Oh, check out that cool surfer dude. Now, great job, boys and girls. Give yourselves a whoop, whoop, raise the roof. Whoop, whoop, raise the roof. Don't forget, you can also stop and play it again to review the five oceans, or you can go back and review the seven continents.
Well, boys and girls, that's it, Patsy, for today's lesson. I hope you enjoyed learning about the five oceans and seven continents. Well, before we go, don't forget to stay home, stay safe, and continue to make good choices. I'll see you when I see you. Here's our goodbye song.
Goodbye, my friend. So long until we meet again. Today's lesson has come to an end. Goodbye, my friend. I will see you again. Goodbye. Stay home, stay safe, and make good choices.